Blog Talk Radio.
Crap, we lost. Mark, you have to intro. We lost Jesse for a minute or two here.
Did you stop it? Did you stop the music?
Yeah.
God damn it, Winfree. Hello, and welcome to a shit-tastic and beginning to what should hopefully be a better podcast. This is Alan Mormont, and I am not the host, your mandated reporter, and frankly, I'm mortified at how this is beginning, Mr. Mark Radulich. Our actual host, who leads us in the
We got him. He's back.
Oh my God! Shut up.
What are you trying to do, an intro here or something?
Yes, you asshole. Jesus, why are all the sex? Anyway, our usual host who gets us started with the literature part of this podcast, Jesse Starcher, got accidentally disconnected. But I believe we have him now.
I think so.
The magic of podcasting.
Yeah.
Jesse Starcher, are you there?
I am. I am here. 2 seconds into the intro, and then I get disconnected. You got to love it.
Yeah, well, I'm glad it's Blog Talk Radio.
I blame,
you. Hey, you want to pull this?
I blame British rock and roll.
You want to pull this podcast? You want to pull this podcast out of the fucking toilet and get on with this?
I guess we could give it a shot. Ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, welcome to another, the third installment for Alan Moore Month. This is a very special night. Now, not only are we 3/4 of the way through this you know, nothing but unicorns and smiles going through the literature that Alan Moore has bestowed upon us, but tonight, my friends, is the 2-year anniversary of my own comic book podcast right here on the Radulich and Broadcasting Network. That is Source Material. And I cannot think of any better way than to spend it with my good friends here. You know, 2 years ago, if you would have said, hey, Jesse, you're going to have a comic book podcast that lasts for 2 years, and on the night of your 2-year anniversary, you're actually going to be on a podcast with none other than the man you just heard there earlier. His name is Mark Radulich, and none other than the great 411 ground and pound host himself, Robert Winfree. I would have said, oh man, I cannot wait. 2 years can't get here fast enough. And then if you would have said, no, that ain't it. That's not it, Jesse. You got to understand, you have a third person you're going to be on the podcast with, and his name is Ronnie Adams. What do you think of that? And I'd be like, I don't know who the hell that is. You see, 2 years ago. 2 years ago, I had not met Ronnie Adams at that time. It took us a couple months before we actually got our minds together and started putting more and more work into this thing we call Source Material. But let's go ahead and get on with the subject of this show. First off, Mark Radulich, did you tell the people how you were doing tonight? Are you doing okay?
Well, until Winfree forgot how podcast worked and just started, you know, butting in and stopping music without cues or anything, I was doing great. Now I'm a little flabbergasted. I'm a little.
Oh.
I'm trying to hold it together.
That'll pass, it'll my pass. Friend. That'll pass. We're going to get into the groove here real quick. Let me go ahead and bring on Robert Winfree, sir. How are you doing? Don't listen to Mark Radulich. I know you don't most of the time, but I mean, don't let him give you a hard time. How you doing tonight, man?
I'm good. I can fluster Mark. Makes me happy.
That puts a smile on anybody's face. And Ronnie Adams, buddy, I'm glad to know you for a year and a half at least, or a little bit more. But, man, how are you doing tonight?
I'm unrecognizable and forgettable, apparently.
No, he's unforgettable.
No,
my
forgettable.
Man, you all.
No,
that's
I'm good,
okay.
Man.
You doing all right? How's the physical media in the mansion you're living in? Just got to get that out of the way.
I live in a mansion. A mansion.
And he enjoys his physical media. Oh, boy. Well,
and
okay.
I'm shunned for it.
Yeah, you're an outcast, my friend. So this evening, our third literary tome from Alan Moore is one none other than V for Vendetta. So for those of you, I don't know if you've listened to the previous two shows or not, but let me go ahead and give you a quick intro as to what the purpose of our show for Alan Moore Month is. What we're going to do is we're going to get a little bit into the discussion of the book tonight, and then we're also going to discuss the movie. Each one of these works that we've discussed has at first been a book and then was adapted into a film. So we're going to kind of talk, you know, number one, about the theme of the book and the theme of the story. We're also going to talk about the movie and what we liked about the movie as well. So I hope you guys, if you haven't had a chance to listen to the first two episodes, you're just hopping in here. The third episode, that's perfectly fine. Go back and listen to the previous two where we covered Watchmen and The League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. So Alan Moore puts together this V for Vendetta in the early 80s, I believe. A lot of talk about how this story was a kind of as his thoughts on the Margaret Thatcher administration over there in jolly good old England. And we're going to kind of talk a little bit about that tonight, but there are some overreaching themes in this particular book that and this story that are, I mean, really, really can be, I guess I would say, you could look at these and see parallels to today and in our recent times. This is a very timeless story, in my opinion, but we'll get into that. Let me go ahead real quick before we get into our discussion. I have got Mark Radulich. Are you ready for this? You always say, give us 50 words or less. Okay. Well, I wrote 109, so be ready. Here we go. Here is too much. Here is my description of V for Vendetta. All right. V for Vendetta is a story about a victim of a rather fascist government and its abhorrent practices. Escaping from a horror-filled government resettlement camp, our protagonist V embarks upon exacting revenge amongst all that were involved. Along the way, V rescues and later befriends a young woman by the name of Evie. Evie could best be characterized as a person struggling to make ends meet in this harsh world that she finds herself in. We are then taken along the ride as V opens Evie's eyes and England's to the oppressive government that is in place and how fear of such government may not be so necessary. So there's my 109-word summary of V for Vendetta. I think that's like 109 words. That's like less than half the pages that V for Vendetta has. But don't get me wrong, folks. It's a great story. So let's talk a little bit about the creators. Of course, our writer's Alan Moore, the great Alan Moore, who's wrote so many tremendous stories. We won't get into too much about him, and if you guys have any insight about Alan Moore in this particular story, we'll definitely let you guys say your piece. However, our artist, okay, now this graphic novel, from what I understand, is put together of a lot of little stories that came out in, and I should have looked this up. I think it was in it was like backstories of comics. I don't know if it was an anthology. But they put all these stories together. That's one of the things I noticed with this graphic novel was the fact that there wasn't like – we were so used to Watchmen and maybe even League of Extraordinary Gentlemen. You had these chapter breaks That really doesn't happen in here. All you get is kind of like the whole story runs together, and every once in a while, well, every a good bit, you'll see a title of the new chapter you're running into. But as for the art itself, I want to go ahead and give props to David Lloyd, who he has he's done a tremendous job on here. This is the early 80s. As far as his career goes, I was looking at some of the stuff that he has done in the past. One of the things that struck my eye, and I know, Ronnie Adams, you'd be all over this. If you can catch these back issues, man, go ahead and do so. But apparently he did some work on Doctor Who comics, I believe. At least Doctor Who magazine. And may have even partnered with Alan Moore, according to what I was reading here, with some great Doctor Who stories. I'm all about that, by the way. And then Hellblazer. I think you mentioned Hellblazer there, Winfree. David Lloyd has his hands in some Hellblazer stories as well. Looks like early 90s stuff. Let's go ahead. I mean, Ronnie Adams, David Lloyd, you got any – I mean, it doesn't look like this guy has an extensive resume. What do you think of his work in V for Vendetta? Anything that strikes you here?
That's a good question.
I like to ask
when those. I was not prepared to answer. Visually, I think it's a little different. It's a little more realistic than from what I remember. Like I said, it's been a little while since I've actually read the book.
Uh-huh.
But from what I can remember, I thought it was really good art.
Yeah,
I know that's intelligent.
Really good's all right. I think that's all right. It seemed like there wasn't a whole lot of, and David Lloyd's probably separate from the colorist here, but
yeah,
it wasn't
as flashy as like your superhero comics.
Yeah, this is definitely something you could see from the 80s, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
Okay. One of the things I probably failed to mention in my summary was the fact that this V character that we're getting ready to talk about is almost he's faceless. He wears a mask. Now let's go ahead and we'll maybe break down some character roles here and what you guys think of him. Winfree, we'll start with you, man. V, you know, the main character himself, the main protagonist. What's your thoughts on Alan Moore's representation of this hero here?
Well, V's a really interesting character in both the iterations we're going to talk about. Actually, the differences that occur between the characters in the shift from the book to the movie are very a couple of them are pretty good, but you can also tell they're clearly the product of trying to make this a much more accessible character in a lot of ways, because the character of V within the context of the novel is, I mean, they label him a terrorist, and that's not inaccurate.
Mm-hmm.
It's just, there's a very important phrase that seems to have removed itself from our cultural lexicon when it comes to these things. And I don't know exactly when it happened, but there exist such things as terrorist governments. You know, things that are so totalitarian, so invasive that they themselves, you know, function via terror rather than consent of the people. At which point, you know, fighting them via terror and, you know, becomes more acceptable. It's not nearly as cut and dry an issue as, you know, we, especially Americans, tend to think of it. And there is the old adage, of course, that one man's terrorist is another man's freedom fighter. V, in this instance, is great because he remains so anonymous for the majority. I mean, for a character who is as front and center as he is to the story, he is essentially anonymous. You never see his face. You never know his name. You never really know his backstory other than the immediately preceding events that led to him taking up his cause. And that's very deliberate. I mean, the whole final exchange between him and Evie in the book is meant to be representative of that. It doesn't matter who he is. It's what he stands for. And V is a relatively articulate, interesting character to put forth anarchy as a political philosophy to those who are not familiar with it beyond the barest trappings. I mean, and yeah, that's very helpful for me. I mean, this was one of the important books that after I read it, I actually became more interested in what anarchy is rather than simply because it gets paired with chaos in you know, discussion frequently. And they're actually quite different things.
Mm-hmm.
There are certainly similarities to them, but there are differences. And V's, as a character, is very good at articulating those. He says a lot of interesting things. He speaks mostly in iambic pentameter. A lot of his dialogue is literary allusion, or allusions to other things. I think the first thing he says to the bishop before he kills him in the book is, please allow me to introduce myself. I'm a man of
wealth and taste,
which is, of course, a line from the Rolling Stones song, Sympathy for the Devil.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah, V's a very interesting character in that regard, and it's a really interesting challenge from both the artistic and the writing standpoint to convey things with him when he's just wearing, you know, a Guy Fawkes mask, and it becomes even more impressive when Hugo Weaving is able to do it in the movie. Real briefly, David Lloyd did do some of the coloring on this.
Okay.
The other two colorists were Steve Whitaker and this is an Irish name, so I'm going to butcher the pronunciation.
Do it with an Irish accent. It makes it that much more fun.
I'm not going to do it with an Irish accent. Sheehan Dodds, and I know I'm mispronouncing that, because S-I-O-B-H has a very different pronunciation from what it looks like phonetically if you're Irish, and I don't know how to pronounce it. I know it's different, but I've not spoken it or heard it spoken enough to feel confident in how it's actually pronounced.
I hear you. Well, it's funny how you mention anonymous. And for those of you that have not read this book, but have been, you know, a purveyor of online for quite a while, which, you know, hey, it's 2016, you damn well better be. Anonymous might be something that you synonymize with what you see in V for Vendetta, because it's the Guy Fawkes mask. That's the representation. Every time you see that online, and it's interesting to try and think that, or actually to contemplate that these guys are taking something from, it's either they're taking it from this work or they're taking it from, you know, remember the 5th of November.
They're taking it from V for Vendetta from what I've read.
Okay. Mark Radulich, I'm glad you're here, sir. What's your thoughts on V?
Hey, remember me? I'm on this podcast. it's fine. What I've read of the book, and I'll in the interest of full disclosure, I haven't read the whole thing, but what I've read of him. It's very Moore-y. God, Moore is not terse in his writing. He is very wordy. And I feel like he likes to. It's almost like in his works. And this isn't the right phrase, but stay with me here. Like the phrase, he likes to hear the sound of his own voice. Moore just writes dialogue for characters. As if, like, he's got all of this stuff that he wants to say, and he has these characters that say it for him, and none of them know when to stop talking, and it's distracting. I found that as one of the elements of his character to be somewhat distracting. I don't know how necessary it was, and maybe Winfrey's listening to this and wanting to bang his head on the wall, but I don't know how necessary it was to the overall message of the movie, of the book. You know, if we're talking about fascism versus anarchy, I'm pretty sure you could still get there without going on 20-minute rambles, before you blow something up or stab someone. I mean, I'm not saying he needed to be Jason or anything, or Freddy. You know, a little clip here, a little snap there. But, just, you know, get to it. I mean, do we it comes across as overdramatic. Because to some degree, you've got to, hang on, to some degree, you've got a very serious subject here that needs to be treated seriously, and the readers, it should, you know, should be invoking some very deep thought, and I feel like instead of being able to do that, you're just caught up in this guy doing something completely unrealistic. If I come at you, Jesse, in a dark alley and brandish a knife and then proceed to start quoting Julius Caesar, you're going to run away. You're not going to stand there and let me do it. Or you're going to shoot one of the two. It's American. You'll probably shoot me. So it just, that got on my nerves.
Mark, I have to ask, have you started reading From Hell yet?
Dude.
Oh, I know what this is.
You better have a damn time machine, because I started that in July, I think it was when I first originally got. I started in July, and then I posted probably about a month ago. I'd finally finished it. Wow. Yeah, if you want to talk about Wordy, we'll definitely be talking Wordy next week. But I think as for V himself, it is endearing to the character for him to be so over the top and such a large production. Because number one, as we look through this book, and the book and the movie, you know, they are decent representations, we'll say. So as he is put into the internment camp or the relocation camp, whatever they called it, and they proceed to do like crazy experiments on this guy. Now, see, we get a nice little flashback origin, you know, about the middle of the book, maybe a little bit before the middle of the book, explaining why he's doing this. But I mean, he goes through some absolute hell, which most likely is going to make you crazy in the first place. Especially if you've come across the decision that, hey, okay, well, it's time for me to start, you know, blowing up buildings and opening up people's eyes. He's come to some point in his life where he's just like, he either can't deal with it or he's dealing with it in his own way. And I think that is why we get this, V for Vendetta, and almost every other word in that tirade that he does starts with a V. He clearly put some thought into this, and he's very smart. He's not he's not your run-of-the-mill stupid terrorist. This guy is somebody that has put, well,
you're the terrorist, you fucking moron,
idiots. You know, this guy has given his a lot of thought to the way society is. So he's not stupid, and I think the whole over the top speaking thing, in my opinion, that just, you know, again, that adds to his character. That adds that level of, is this guy crazy or is he like really, is he really intelligent? Ronnie Adams, what do you think? What do you think of that? Do you think he's just, is he doing too much here?
There's a thin line when you write a character like this between intelligence and insanity. I mean, most of your great villains are incredibly intelligent. You know, you think of the Joker, Lex Luthor, all those guys. Is he a villain? I mean, yes and no, to a point. Obviously, he's our hero in this book, but anti-hero, whatever you want to call him. So he's got to, you know, to say that, to go to the extremes of blowing things up and stabbing people to get his point across. He's a little crazy. He's a little touched, but he's also incredibly intelligent. But as you say, he's gone through a lot of hell, and maybe he doesn't. I don't know. Maybe he doesn't know how else to deal with it. So he's a multifaceted, very deep character that is very, very interesting.
What do you think, Winfree?
Well, the styling of this character as unhinged and somewhat debatable in as far as is he a good guy or is he not is very deliberate on the part of Alan Moore. In fact, he's talked about this in the past. His goal was not to necessarily preach the virtues of anarchy from the perspective of a hero, of, you know, an of an implacable paragon of virtue. V kills people. He bombs major buildings. He stabs people in the street. He is... there's some stuff wrong with this guy. And that's very intentional, in the same way that the officers of the government are not, in the book at least, stock villains. They have character. They have relationships. They have character arcs. They're fleshed out. They're three-dimensional. They're not... This is not, oh, this is the valiant freedom fighter overcoming the corrupt government, and that's how it's going to be. This is a slightly unhinged guy in a clearly unfortunate situation who has gone so far to one extreme that you now begin questioning whether or not you do have to question his methodology, his message, and things of that nature. And the same is true of the government in the sense that, you know, these are not good people necessarily. They're at least the supreme, you know, the high chancellor is, you know, pretty substantial racist.
Yeah.
And you look at the things they've done. This is not a good thing, but there's also a bit of, well, in the book, at least England has survived elements of a nuclear war that took place throughout much of the rest of the world. And commensurate with the unthinkable happening, hard choices have to be made, and okay, we don't agree with all of them, but you know, these are not necessarily evil people. I mean, I don't think a whole lot good about the Chancellor, but the most human element of the government is probably Finch, who's also the most interesting.
Yeah, I'd agree with that. Finch being our he's our police detective, correct? Is that the guy he's kind of like the guy
that's
chief inspector. He's the one that's on, he's on the trail of V for our ears, eyes, nose, mouth, whatever they call their sections of government there. Finch, just like you said, as we watch him go through this particular story, you know, I find him more of the guy I identify with in this particular story, because he's like, you know, he's the dude that's just, he's working a job. He believes in, I mean, if I was working there and I saw some of the stuff that went down, you know, such as these buildings being blown up, of course, the one person I would be mad at is these, you know, the responsible party behind that. But then you really start to comprehend and understand the reasons why this is being done. And you're a soldier, you're a, I don't want to say puppet, but you're a, you know, you're a part of that government. He works for the government. So let's go ahead and Ronnie, do you have, and Chief Inspector Finch here, do you have any particular tomes you'd like to, or any particular insight you'd like to give upon what you thought of his character in any way?
Well, the whole situation, there's no real black or white. It's a bunch of gray. It's a bunch of situations you have to look at and go, yeah, but I may agree with him on some things about the government being, you know, corrupt, but you don't have to kill people and blow things up. And kill people to get your point across.
Yeah.
You know, no matter what, murder is murder.
Mm-hmm.
I guess it would be his stance. There's a certain set of laws he has to go by and that he has to uphold. and he's trying to do his best to uphold those, even though some of the stuff, he's the one as well that I put myself in his situation. How would I react to that if I had that job? And it was very much of a yeah, but, these people in higher offices may be lying, may be, corrupt, but there are better ways of doing this than being a terrorist.
Let me butt in here and talk about just the overall mentality of people who live through traumatic times and are, in the case of this story, portrayed as accepting the strong leader and then everything that goes with that. There is some psychology to the idea of needing stability in unstable times. When there are bread shortages and riots and water is contaminated and the air is hardly breathable, you don't care anymore about the little freedom. What you want is for somebody to rise up and take control of the situation. And you're willing to cash in, speaking in general, you're willing to cash in some of your freedom, for just peace of mind, safety of your family, to know that there's a strong man out there keeping the animals at bay from harming you and your children. And there's a certain amount of loyalty that goes along with that. You are the one that saved us from the brink of doom. And it's not like these things happen overnight. They happen incrementally. And there's arguments put forward for why the good children of a society, and I'm using that as the population at large, the government is the parent, and you're all the good, the society is the good children, why you just let the parent lead and take control. And people are willing to do this to a degree. And suddenly over the years, as you've given up one thing after another, suddenly you find yourself in this totalitarian nightmare where you have no freedom, and you have guys, secret police, brutally murdering and raping in the streets without anyone there to stop them. And you can convince yourself that it's all, we don't want to go back to the dark times. You just learn to sort of accept and accept and accept until you're made to confront it. And I think that's his story. Vince's story in this book is that he, along with everybody else, took the trip from the darkness into perceivably the light. And his arc is when he's finally sort of shaken and woken up and made to look at the harsh reality of what he and society has allowed to happen, he can't handle it anymore. He has to do something. It's almost unbelievable that he sat and was a part of a government that was doing horrendous things. So that's sort of my take on him and sort of the society portrayed in the book in general. And I think that's the most appealing thing to me is the idea of we're only going to accept so much, and then eventually someone reminds us, oh, yeah, freedom is the best way to live.
That's true.
Not this way. And it sort of takes... It takes a guy making a sacrifice like V sometimes to sort of show people, okay, well, you don't have to go to all buildings necessarily, but you do have to stand up and say, we will not accept the government anymore. This government is false. This government is this government is without any sort of moral integrity. And it has to change. You no longer live in this society. We're far enough away from the dark that we've gone past the light and we're in the dark again. We need to sort of independence.
Yeah, you need a catalyst. A catalyst, a spark that you know, explosion of revolution, I guess is the best way to say it. Let me go ahead. We got a special caller here, one guy I couldn't wait to hear from. So I believe we have Benjamin J. Cologne on the line who I can't wait to hear his input on here. Benjamin, can you hear me?
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, sir. Welcome to the show, man. Alan Moore month. You know, I've learned so much from Alan Moore, and a lot of it was because of you actually kind of interpreting his stuff for me, which, you know, sometimes you need that translator that's down to earth, because a lot of this stuff can get pretty heady, and by golly, some country boy from Ohio sometimes can't get it. So, Benjamin, you, sir, have come on here. I what do you want to talk about, man? V for Vendetta.
Yeah, I called in. I noticed that this podcast was grossly underpopulated, so I decided to weigh in. Also, because I don't get a whole lot of opportunity to talk about V for Vendetta, and V for Vendetta is one of my favorite stories, comic book or otherwise, of all time. It's just beginning to end. It's probably my favorite thing Alan Moore has ever done, which is saying something for me, considering how big an Alan Moore fan I am. And, you know, I don't want to, you know, take up too much real estate on this show, but I just wanted to weigh in, you know, when the opportunity comes up with, you know, a lot of things that I love about the comic in particular. I like the movie, not quite as much as I love the comic, but the movie, I think, is a very good adaptation that has its own interesting diversions, and also some, you know, great similarities when it's necessary for those to exist. I guess you know, it's hard to know where to start.
Let me ask you. I mean, what was it like when you first read this? Now, usually, you know, there's the kind of the questions I asked the people on source material when they get a hold of a book and they first read something. What was it like? Now, Alan Moore is a revolutionary writer. Was that something that hit you immediately after you picked this up? And I assume you read it in graphic novel form straight through. Is that right?
Yeah.
What'd you think, man? I mean, how did it affect you? Can you give us an idea?
What you pick up about Alan Moore's writing across the board, because he's worked with a lot of different artists, very, very talented artists, some of the greatest of all time, but you notice, you know, common threads in everything that he does, because as we've talked about on source material, Alan Moore is very hands-on with his scripts, and an Alan Moore comic book script is very, very, very dense.
Indeed.
Very detailed, and very much, you know, there's a lot of direction given, you know, and which is probably intimidating to some artists, and you know, you've got to be good to kind of keep up with the guy. And as Mark said, he's got a lot to say. Sometimes he's got more to say than you would think can, you know, efficiently fill up a page. But the storytelling in this book, there are very few comics that I've ever read in my life. There are very few books of any kind that I've ever read in my life that have elicited a verbal response from me, that have elicited an actual physical, emotional response from me in the moment that I read them. V for Vendetta is one of those books. And I don't know how far into the story we want to get for me to explain which particular scene that is.
Save it. We're going to go across our favorite moments here in just a few before we change it over to movie talk with Mark Radulich. So, okay. All right. Well, let's do one more character talk here about Evie. You know, we talked about Finch. We talked about V. Do you have any quick thoughts about V there? That's probably – I don't want to limit you there, Benjamin. But, you know, what do you think about V as a character? Is this somebody that was just what do you think, man?
Ronnie actually brought up some points that I very much agree with, in that V in the comic is a charismatic, and Mark also said, you know, pretty verbose guy in the comic. And he has, you know, there's the thing about Alan Moore writing and Alan Moore characters is that most of them are pretty gray and most of them are pretty morally ambiguous. And that's kind of the point most of the time. I can get into this more when we talk about particular like scenes and my favorite, you know, parts of this book, but V is, he has an ideology, he has a moral code, he has a plan, but he's still insane. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, he's still a madman. That's not to say that he's not necessarily, you know, you can ascribe your own moral judgment on the things that he's doing and the reasons why he's doing them. But ultimately, and we'll get into this more, he's his mission is a suicide mission, and he knows it. And it's not completely apparent to everybody, including the reader at first, but the farther you go into the story, you realize everything that he's doing is basically like he knows this is the last thing I'm going to do, and this is going to end with me dead, but that's okay.
Yeah. There were times when I was reading this story, looking at it and saying, you know, he knows what he's doing. You could almost see that he knows that just like you said, it was a suicide mission. I picked up on that a little bit because I was like, how do you think this is going to freaking end, dude? I mean, you've got the cover of the mask. Okay. And nobody knows who you are, but you keep pressing the issue. It's not like this guy, you know, goes off, blows one building up, and then he, with the purpose of taking the mask off and remain hidden, and he can get away scot-free. No, that's not the case. He is out to prove a point, and he proceeds to do so. All right, let's talk Evie here. Go ahead, Ronnie.
Oh, I was going to say, well, that's kind of where I was going with that. It's almost like he doesn't realize that if he keeps pressing that point, if he keeps taking the route that he's taken, yes, he will end the tyranny that he has, that he so loathes, that, you know, that he can't. But he's also going to plunge everybody into a darker point. You know, yes, the end of the tyranny is there, but also, if there's no structure at all, then it goes into a much darker, you know, well, not a much darker, but a different darker point of time for that government. It's going to be, for lack of a better term, it's going to be anarchy at its worst.
Yeah, there wouldn't be much
it's
of a government left.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's going to go from anarchy to chaos to just to pure lawlessness.
Mm-hmm. All right, let's talk Evie. There's so much I want to say. I know we definitely don't have 3 hours on this podcast, and this book can be discussed honestly at 5 hours easy. Ronnie, I'll start with Robert Winfree. What's your thoughts on our heroine? I guess, and you call her a heroine. I don't know if we would call her a heroine here. She's kind of our. Kind of our analog here, human analog for this story, is someone that's brought under the wing of V, and that's Evie. Can you give us your thoughts on Evie?
Now, Evie is an interesting character in the book, much more so than in the movie in numerous, numerous ways. And when we compare and contrast, we can have some fun with that. she's very, you know, if we're deal. You mentioned she's the human analog. She's very analogous of the society in general, as opposed. I mean, Finch is part of the government, and as you know, the representation of kind of the naivete within that. Then she is the representation of the the vox populi, the average person. As she's very young in the book, when we meet her, she's just 16. She's just kind of desperately trying to get by in this world that is just crap. It's just awful. All she wants to do is get by, and she's... When we meet her, she's turning to the world's oldest profession as a means of paying the bills because, well, her government job just ain't cutting it anymore. And her journey... that's our near-rape scene for the book. There's only the one, but it's Alan Moore, and you can't have an Alan Moore story without at least attempted rape.
That's right.
She takes a very interesting journey in the sense that she starts out, you know, very naive, very kind of helpless, becomes attached to V very quickly, becomes disillusioned with that. He throws her out because she needs to learn about being out in the world a little bit if she's going to try and save it later. Her transformation sequence, and this is probably my favorite part of the entire book, are the chapters that deal with her after she's been captured. Just tremendously well written and wonderfully illustrated as well. And then in the end, she actually takes up the physical mantle of V. She doesn't, and this is different from the movie for those of you who haven't seen it, but have not read the book. After V is mortally wounded by Finch and subsequently dies, she actually dons the same costume to give the appearance to the general population that, yeah, he's... No, report, as she actually uses the line, reports of my demise are exaggerated. Of course, a joke on the famous Mark Twain quote. And actually winds up taking, I believe, the Inspector Dominic Stone to be... to fill the role that she had in the beginning of the book as kind of learning from... She learned from V, now he's going to learn from her, and kind of continuing the notion that whoever is behind the mask isn't terribly relevant. It's more what it stands for. And the fact that she goes from a very meek, very unassuming, you wouldn't look twice at her if you passed her on the street type of character, to being the physical embodiment in many ways of the anarchist movement, should tell you a lot about her character arc, because it's one of the most complete and one of the more believable ones in the story. That's all I got.
Did we lose Jesse again?
I don't know.
Can we take a sense of who's still on this podcast?
He's still in the switchboard.
Yeah, I see him. All right, let's keep this moving on here. Here we go. I got a message from Jesse here. And Jesse says, I can hear every word. Good for you, Jess. I'm gonna mute him and then unmute him and see if that works. Jesse? Jesse, just dial back in. I'm going to exit you from the switchboard. I'll call back in. Good. All right, I'll keep things moving.
Well, I think the next segment we usually do is favorite parts of the comic, so we can probably transition into that, right?
Well, hang on. Ben, did you want to say anything about Evie?
Me personally, I'm inclined to agree with most of the stuff that Robert was saying. I tried very hard in terms of the movie not to allow my very longtime crush on Natalie Portman color my opinion of her performance in the movie. That didn't really work. She was great. She was good enough to where it almost did make her her performance and her portrayal of Evie in the movie more interesting to me than it was in the book, which is saying something about, you know, considering how much I love everything in this book. I've always thought Alan Moore's kind of weakest point, at least in his books up until going towards the later 90s, was writing women. It works in his favor that Evie's kind of kind of the audience proxy in this move in this story, and that plays that plays better towards the end of the story where her ultimate character arc is realized than it does in the beginning. In the beginning, she's actually fairly I found her fairly uninteresting up until the point where she did get captured. Except for the little brief uncertainty that V kind of hinted and then denied that he was her father, which I'm also I think Alan Moore would have gone with something quite that corny, but I'm also glad that they didn't go that way in the movie either. Even though the way that they did go, I didn't care too much for either.
The Ice Spartacus thing at the end.
No, I didn't mind that part, but just sort of the romance that they tried to
injected
into the movie. That didn't. I didn't.
Oh boy, are we gonna get there?
Yeah.
Do you, like you said, I missed out on a little bit of it there. I was going in and out, but do you think that that Evie was in the movie and mostly in the book was a representation of the population as a whole? To lift the veil off of our eyes to see what's going on around us and kind of a deal, or do you think she was just a specific character that he wrote for this?
Before anyone answers that question, the word I was looking for earlier was illegitimate. The government is illegitimate, and the people needed to stand up and tear it down. Okay, go on.
Were you asking me specifically, Ronnie, or is that just like in general?
Just in general, but yes. Yeah, go for it.
I think she, as a character, she started out as kind of an example of the greater, population and sort of how indoctrinated they had become into all of the, into the idea of fascism. And then, she had kind of her awakening, and then she became more of her own character as the story goes on.
All right, can I ask a question to the general group? And it's based on stuff that I've read outside of the book. Doing some reading about mainly about why Moore was so upset about the film version versus the book. What came out of that was he was very much with this book trying to depict arguments for and against, and Winfree, back me up if I'm not getting this right, but it was sort of a philosophical debate between anarchy and fascism, and it's kind of there's a defense for both point of view, and that V is ambiguous and the government is ambiguous, and it's really up to the reader to decide who's right and who's wrong, which is one of his problems with the film was it was pretty straightforward. You had a guy, who was trying to tear, take control back from a government that has gone out of control. But here's sort of my question, unless there's any vigorous debate about what I just said, and that is anarchy even defensible? And I think that's where I struggle with V for Vendetta. Because as I read what I've read of it and read the writings on it via secondary literature and watched the film, we had a discussion today in Messenger. And I want to go, and I kind of want to kick this up into the discussion. How is anarchy even morally defensible? I mean, it's one of the whole points.
It's really not that hard to defend anarchy, actually, from a philosophical perspective.
No, I want it from a realistic standpoint.
Oh, well, then.
If you're, that's where I'm going with this. And I want you guys to weigh in. I don't want to just hog all the airtime here, but this really got to me. Here you have a guy who's like, no, I have this debate in my mind about fascism and anarchy, and we need to digest that. We need to think about it. And I'm going the entire time, are you crazy? Anarchy is defensible.
I can take a stab at it.
Huh? What'd you say? Ben, what'd you say?
I can take a stab at it, no pun intended. Well, maybe a little bit of a pun intended.
Why don't you just cut it in the bud? Go ahead.
I'm talking about, this is not necessarily my point of view, but from the point of view of V in the book, and I really wish I could find the page in the book where this is said, because I know it's said. V's defense of anarchy is basically his very, it's a very idealized and very romanticized view of what anarchy is, which does not necessarily have any basis in reality given what we know about human nature and human beings. And what he says is basically his concept of anarchy and his idealized romanticized concept of anarchy is basically where there is no need for leadership and there is no need for greater structure, be it government or otherwise.
I know the line you're talking about, actually.
Right.
It's right after chaos starts. He and Evie are talking about it. He says anarchy is without leaders, not without order. Something along those lines.
Something like that, and where, people do not necessarily have to abide by any particular rules, but they are capable of imposing restrictions upon themselves. Something to that effect, which, I can't possibly be the most cynical person on this podcast, although if I am, I understand. Knowing what we know about human nature and what we know about human beings, of course, that's not a realistic, idea for, a framework of society. But that's his defense. That's how he sees it and how he believes that, that's what he believes is the superior alternative to fascism and the fascism that's being imposed on the England in which this story takes place.
Okay, so I'm going to say something very insulting, okay? And you guys feel free to then say, well, rattle it, you're a crazy person. I'm long road to ruin. If I think it and it's out there, I'm going to say it. Alan Moore is a fucking child. Okay, this is how a child thinks. Wouldn't it be great if there weren't any rules? And
Agree with you, but I've been to way too many college campuses to limit that thinking to children at this point in time.
I'm gonna devil's advocate this just a little bit. I don't necessarily believe this is 100% Alan Moore speaking through the character. I don't think this is his concrete view of what anarchy is, and throughout the story you're not necessarily V is ostensibly the protagonist of the story, but Moore kind of puts him in the book, in the story. Some of the things he does, you're kind of meant to consider very questionable, very suspect, and you're not necessarily meant to agree with all of these things that he does. I don't think this is 100% Moore saying, this is what I believe and this is what, what it should be. It's presenting two extremes. It's presenting two very extreme ideologies that happen to clash with each other in this story. Realistically, I don't think Alan Moore 100% believes it. He's been pretty vocal about the fact that he's basically an anarchist. But this particular type of anarchy that he's presenting in this story, I don't necessarily believe that that's, his direct beliefs, nor do I necessarily, is it important for me to think that it is or isn't for me to be able to understand what's going on in the story and enjoy what, the sort of dynamic that he's set up.
Okay.
To answer your question, Mark, anarchy is defensible from a practicality standpoint about as much as socialism is. Just to say it isn't. But there's a bunch of morons who tend to think it is.
Okay. To go to Ben's point, I will go with you on that. I can't for certain say one way or the other, so your explanation's as good as any. However, it's kind of like, you know, debating the merits of the moon is made of green cheese. Well, it's not. We know that. Okay, it just isn't. But I believe it is. It might be. But can't we consider it? No, because we know it's not. We have evidence of this. And the thing of it is that there have been studies about socialistic societies, communes where there are no leaders and everyone is equal. And in small, and studies have shown that in small groupings, that kind of thing works. We'll call it anarchy. There have been small communes that have been, and over hundreds and hundreds of years, small pockets of society with very few people in them, where there was no single elected strong man or leader. But in large, great societies, with complex things going on, it doesn't work at all. And I don't know if it hardly warrants a debate, I guess was the point that I was trying to make, is even if he's not saying, I am an anarchist and let's have anarchy, he is in fact saying, let's have a debate about this. Let's give it some thought. And again, I go back to why. Why does this merit serious thought when it's such an asinine concept in practicality? I don't let anyone jump in here and answer that for me.
Well, there's a couple of ways to approach that one. One is that if you're attempting to start a debate, a bit of civil discourse, a bit of discussion, you have to start somewhere. And in reality, the antithesis of whatever is not working at the time, however extreme that may be, is not the worst place in the world to start from. And when you consider that Moore wrote this in the early 80s as a response to Thatcherism in the United Kingdom, and I'm not British, but that was a very interesting bit of time for that culture, to the best of my knowledge, for that country. Going to the other extreme is not just as a means of offering a counter argument, as a means of offering contrast, as a means of saying, okay, you say this is right, I say this is right, support your case, please, is not the most ludicrous thing in the world in terms of simply getting civil discourse going. If we're actually implementing a rule structure, no, that's not really how that works, but if you just need to get people talking because you think change is necessary, taking the exact opposite stance of the commonality point of view isn't the worst thing in the world.
One of the things that I noticed, I'm back and I'm ringing a bell. So V for Vendetta, you guys were talking about the difference between what Alan Moore is what V is representing versus what the government is representing, and I think that this story, I apologize if I am repeating what you guys may have already said. I just got back in here. I heard a little bit, but it's two extremes, and they come together in this crazy form in this book where. I don't think V's intention, then again, maybe he loves anarchy enough to where he's going to bring everything down. But I think his intention is to bring everything down and then build back up from that. And you'll notice there's a couple references in the books or in the book that where he talks about things have to be destroyed in order for us to build again and build anew. So the purpose of anarchy in this particular book, I think, is not a long-term solution in any way. It's a very temporary thing that has to happen in order to get people to open up their eyes and rebuild from the rubble something better. How's that sound?
I mean, that's fine. And I think in terms of a story, don't get me wrong. I don't dislike the story. I like it a lot. I think where I got hung up on was the idea of you have an author who aches to share a point of view, and that point of view is interesting from a college lecturer level, as you know, that was sort of my answer to what Rob said, but I wanted to let Jesse get back in on the discussion. I think if you're in a classroom environment and you're just, let's talk about ideas from the dumbest to the smartest, sure, there's a debate to be had. But I think if you're trying to say something about the greater society at large and say, you know, and look, there's a degree of paranoia in this book. And I think in the mind of Moore, there's definitely paranoia. In the time that, I mean, we've seen it in The Watchmen, we not necessarily The Extraordinary Gentleman, but we definitely see it in V for Vendetta, that he has an idea of what was going on at that time and where things were going. And it was an idea shared by many. I don't know how many of you guys have read 1984, but the idea that...
Just a couple of times.
You know, the idea that we've had two world wars, we've had two atomic bombs dropped, we are in the nuclear age, we have come through a Cold War. You know, these were raw, fresh ideas that were poking people's nerves and causing a lot of paranoia. So I get that. And if you were any kind of a thinking individual in the Reagan/Thatcher-era 80s, yeah, you might have thought the world was going to come to an end or that we were drifting towards fascism. And so I don't fault Moore's point of view for that reason. But in 2016, looking back in retrospect, I'm finding some of the themes here a smidge hollow. Not tremendously, and when you talk about the film, I think it actually becomes extremely more relevant. But I think the idea of we need to consider anarchy in the face of rising fascism now comes to me as you know, tinfoil hat-ish. Not to say it's not a nice story, but I'm having a lot of trouble with the subtext.
Okay. All right. I think it's a fair view, and that's what the point of this book is. The point of this particular work is to make you think, okay, is this something that's okay to do, or is this something that's not okay to do? Because on the face, oh my gosh, it looks horrible. Imagine being a person sitting there and you're in England and all of a sudden, you know, one of the biggest monuments to government just absolutely explodes. I'd be horrified and I would be scared, but my eyes would be open. So I hate – one of the things that we can ask at the end of this, after we talk the movie, but it – one of the things and one of the biggest criticisms about this is – glorifying terrorism. Is V actually right or wrong? And what's good about the book versus the movie is I think Moore did and this is something I definitely did the research on, but I think his purpose was to kind of leave that ambiguous. Leave it up to the reader, which is one of the great things that anybody can do when they write a story or write a comic. Leave it up to the reader to make their decisions on whether this person is right or wrong. So, Mark, when you read this book, it's perfectly a great, valid response for you to sit there and say, I don't think so. When somebody else on this podcast might look at it and say, that's the fucking answer right there. That's the answer. So it's a great way of Alan Moore reaching whoever the reader is, in my opinion. If anybody has anything else they'd like to add, feel free. If not, we'll gladly move on to movie time with Mark Radulich. Anybody? Going once, going twice.
I said I'd mention some of my favorite parts of the book. And in doing so, I wanted to mention parts of the book that were not in the movie that in some cases I really wish were. I can make this fairly quick. Basically, first of all, and now I'm going back and looking at I think it was with Sutler who is the the High Chancellor.
His name is Susan in the book.
Fine. See, that's That's what happens when you see, the movie.
Last watch the movie.
Yeah. But basically, he has basically the supercomputer that called Fate. That kind of a glorified plot device, but there's a great reveal that the reason why V has been able to kind of infiltrate all of his dealings and kind of work his campaign is basically that he was able to reverse engineer the computer and has a version of his own that he's been using to sort of infiltrate this sort of regime from the inside out. That was a great reveal.
Yeah, the voice of Fate, I just want to piggyback on that real quick. A lot of the past few episodes, or the two episodes that we've done so far, I've made a statement about how Alan Moore treats media in these books and its effect or impact on the public. The voice of Fate, which is the guy who supposedly, it reads... tells everybody the information from this computer or whatever, interprets it so everybody can hear it. I mean, imagine somebody that you had to listen to on the public, on NPR, that was called the voice of Fate, okay? This is Fate, of all things. We all look at Fate as a, this etheric substance that may or may not have what's going to happen to us the next day. This is something that's either written in stone or something like that. And it's such an interesting thing to see him take that and apply that to the public and see how the public – because most of the public – and I think this is in the book. He specifically says – maybe it's in the movie. I can't remember. But people will believe easily what's on TV. I don't know how many times that I've changed the channel when I see the president come to the podium. But if instead of the president coming to the podium, they instead decided to disseminate that message throughout programs on TV that like millions of people watch. I know this is nothing revelatory to many people who are pretty smart and understand how media works, but you see that in Alan Moore's work a lot, specifically in this particular book. This is probably one of the loudest that I heard the whole media impact on people message that I've seen. And I don't think he's really overt about it. But anyway, okay, I'm sorry. Benjamin, go ahead. Finish what you were going to say.
No, it's worth mentioning. Next thing that was not in the movie that I wish was from the book, about a third of the way into the book, The Vicious Cabaret.
Oh, that would have been awesome. Because Hugo Weaving could have sung the crap out of that.
It is on YouTube. Somebody has actually performed it, recorded it, and sung it. I encourage anybody who loved that song. It is an actual piece of music that Alan Moore wrote and composed for piano that somebody has deigned to perform. And it may still be on YouTube. I hope it is. I'll probably go back and check it out later on. It says a lot without, in a very short amount of time about what's going on in the story up to that point. Just a tremendous, and it comes kind of out of nowhere, but in kind of the best way. But yeah, try to find the YouTube video if it's still out there. If not, then it's fairly easy enough to remind. Alan Moore's actually got a pretty good ear for music. If you've read The Killing Joke, the really twisted song that the Joker sings in there is another example. next thing. There's a point in here, and this is where V for Vendetta, if you are of a mind to look at it in a certain way, there's a lot of horror elements in V for Vendetta, just in a couple of fundamental ways, in the way that a person who commits murder with a mask completely covering his face and concealing any kind of facial expression is inherently terrifying, and Robert, you're a horror guy like me. you guys, I'm sure, familiar with horror tropes in varying degrees, but that's a bit, you know, that's pretty horrifying, and that's utilized in a lot of ways in this book, where you've got just the blank, you know, dead-eyed Guy Fawkes mask, and you have an idea of what kind of facial expression may be under it at any given time, but you're still not quite sure, and that's a little bit unnerving.
Mm-hmm.
There's also an element of there's another scene where the investigators are putting together all of the evidence. Like, there's a lot of these people have been killed, and they're kind of like putting the pieces together, and they come up with these couple of different scenarios as to why V is doing this. And they say, you know, the first scenario is pretty obvious and it's pretty common, and it's a little bit less unnerving. And that's just that he's insane. He's trying to kill all of these people, and he's committing, you know, these acts of vengeance. And that means he's done and he'll stop, and there's no reason for him to continue. The second scenario is much more disturbing, and that is, what if he's just kind of clearing the decks? What if he's getting rid of everybody who may have known him in his previous life, and he is getting ready to do something even bigger, which we find out very quickly is exactly what is happening.
Yeah.
I love that part, and I wish that was in the movie. The last part, and we mentioned it, Robert mentioned it also, is at the very end, Evie putting on a costume and becoming V. What we got, you know, we got the sort of abstract, you know, everybody takes off the mask, and you see everybody underneath the mask, and all, including characters that we know have passed away, so we know it's a little bit of artistic license at the end of the movie. That's an okay substitute for what we got. I still kind of love the idea that, I love this execution of the idea that V is everybody, and everybody is,
yes,
V, and anybody can be V.
Yeah.
And it's just such a perfect way for the story to end. And you see, you know, once Evie comes to the realization of what she has to do, you know, right before he dies, he tells her something along the lines of, you know, you must know what lies underneath this mask, but you can never know my face.
Yes, yes, yes.
And it takes her a minute to understand what he means by that, but then she gets it. It's like, you know, this is what he means, and this is what I have to do. And you see her with the, you know, with the Guy Fawkes mask smile as that chapter ends, and you know immediately at that point, oh, this is what's going to happen.
Mm-hmm.
The last thing. My favorite part of the story, my favorite single scene in this story, and it's pretty obvious, and I hope it's at least one other person's favorite scene in this. It's when after the torture that's been visited upon Evie, and she is ready to die, and she's got no more illusions left in her, and her torturer, her, you know, jailer basically says, you're free, you've got nothing, there's nothing we can threaten you with, something to that effect. And the revelation and the single page where she emerges, and it's the shadow gallery.
Uh-huh.
That's what I was talking about. That is one of the very few times that I have read anything that actually got a physical response from me. That's what kind of put this book over the top for me. That was just phenomenal for me.
And it's a powerful message. I mean, when you look at it, because at first, my reaction to her being somewhat tortured or whatever, if you want to call it that, it's V looking at somebody and saying, you need to be liberated, and you need to have no fear. And he takes her through this just absolute horrible. I mean, she gets her head shaved. She's put in jail. She's starved. I mean, she comes out of there. She's like, I mean, it's she weighs like 90 pounds. So she's been through a lot. And then, you know, she finds out it's actually V. Of course, your first instinct would be anger. But that is one of the more potent parts of this book, is the fact that as angry as she is, she ends up understanding his ideals and what he did in order to show her and free her from the fear of death, the fear of those who could potentially harm her. It's without a shadow of a doubt the best part of the book, in my opinion. Anything else you want to add there, Benjamin?
Like I said, just if anybody has any desire to like reread this book from the point of view that it's a horror story, and you might get a little something different out of it, because there are some parts where, like, you know, there's a scene where he gets caught outside of, you know, this lady's apartment, and the guy's about to, he's got him point blank, he pulls the trigger and the gun is either empty or misfires.
It's empty. That's the same gun he had been threatening his wife with earlier, with the rather the frequently utilized, you know, abusive husband thing of, you know, he's got the gun, puts it to her head, pulls the trigger, says, bang, it wasn't loaded this time. And then he runs out. And then he runs out after V without actually loading the gun.
This is why I needed to read this again. But yeah, basically the gun, you know, the gun is empty, and all you see is the mask. You don't see anything. There's not a word on the page. There's not a sound effect on the page. But it's the scene of V just lunging at him and obviously repeatedly stabbing him to death. You don't see any of that. All you see is him, like V, like kind of leaning over him and him screaming, and it's silent. And that's creepy as hell.
It is.
And there's a lot of scenes like that if you look at it from that kind of point of view.
Very interesting. I've never thought of that. I mean, I was looking at the political ideals and all that, but reading it from a horror standpoint, that definitely puts a different spin on things. Well, all right. Mark Radulich, sir, you know, I'm not even going to give you much of an introduction. I'm just going to say, take us to the movie, sir. What do you got to say?
All right. Just a real quick. There are some, as Ben has pointed out, there are some changes in the movie from the book, and it made poor Alan Moore sad. I just want to go over them really quick.
It was rubbish.
He frowned the whole time he was cashing his check.
So
I don't think he cashed a check on this one.
No, he didn't.
Really?
He refused it.
Yeah.
Oh, wow. I didn't know that.
What, you know, why is he always bitching about the way his movies are done? Did he not have a role in this? And the impression I got talking to Winfrey earlier was basically he don't know none of this stuff, and DC did, and DC said to Hollywood, hey, here's some Alan Moore stuff that might make some good movies. Have at it. And Moore said, what are you doing with my books? And there we have it. Alan Moore month, a celebration of a man fucked by his former publisher.
Kind of.
Really is.
All right, so V for Vendetta.
That's not the real subtitle of this month.
You know, it kind of explains his obsession with rape, though, doesn't it?
It was a foreshadowing.
I might be wrong in my assumptions, and that might be more on the money. They wrote these before he got fucked. all right. So here we go. Quick run through of the movie. Again, some of this is exactly out of the book. Some of it's a bit of a change. But we have Evie, who is played by Natalie Portman, who is not a prostitute, but instead going to meet her boss after curfew. She gets caught by the finger men. They leave the rape out of it. They're just going to kill her.
They're actually into the rape in that scene than they are in the murder. They're actually they're specifically in the book.
Oh, you're right. Sorry, the one guy just hit his hands down. Okay.
She's got. Yeah, there's no illusions there. There's three of them, and that's going to be a bad night for Natalie Portman.
They were pretty straightforward with it.
Sorry, my mistake. So she's about to get raped and killed. B shows up and kills everybody. Instead of what happens in the book, they separate briefly. There's a whole thing where she goes to her job, which is the Jordan Center, and she works for a guy who has a comedic talk show, the British version of Johnny Carson, from what I was able to gather.
Stephen Fry is so much better than Johnny Carson.
Oh, for God's sake. The cops are out looking for her. B shows up. One of them has him dead to rights. She ends up taking him out, and she gets clocked on the head with a gun. V takes her back to the Shadow Gallery. I'm ripping through this really quick. He says, you got to stay here for a year until next November 5th when the shit goes down, and you better be ready.
Oh, good one.
For thank you. She tricks him into letting her help him with one of his murders, which is the priest. She dresses up as just a lovely little girl. She tries to tell the priest, hey, you're about to be murdered. And he says, that's fine, but I'd still like to rape you. And B comes in, kills him. She makes a run for it. She ends up going to the boss's house, where he shows her his etchings. No, he shows her his gallery of forbidden stuff, which is the Quran. There's explicit photos. There's a picture of the fascist leader looking like Mark Thatcher. All kinds of neat stuff. And he tells her, gay. Stop. On top of that. Shortly thereafter, he decides he's going to go off script and do a show where they make fun of fearless leader, which gets him beaten and killed. She tries to narrowly escape, but is kidnapped. She is tortured. She is asked to give information on V, which she does not. And finally, after a period of time and receiving letters from a former captive who was in prison because she was a lesbian, an actress and all that, she tells her captors, I would rather die than give this man up. At which point, Peter Griffin throws a box of lottery tickets on the floor and says, these are the real tickets. I had to know if you were all serious. Now, what happens is...
He's watching a different movie.
I just watched that the other day.
I'm sorry. That's what that scene came. As soon as I saw that, that's the first thing I thought of. He's like, I was trying to get you over your fear, and now you are fearless. Okay, so he leaves him again. Meanwhile, while all this is happening, he's being hunted by Finch, and along the way, Finch is starting to realize, hey, wait a minute, things are not as they seem. He uncovers the great mystery of who V once was. We get this whole backstory about him being in a concentration camp where they were doing human experimentation of biological weapons. He finds out the secret of St. Mary's pandemic. And he is along the way somewhat convinced that maybe things need to change. There's another character, Curry, who is also convinced by V that if they give up fearless leader, then he shall step up and everything will be fine.
Creedy.
So anyway, moving on. Creedy? Yeah, sorry. Creedy. So everything proceeds to this final end game where he's going to blow up Parliament. There's a whole action sequence where he does kill Fearless Leader, and they shoot Fearless Leader in the head. V's there. Then they have a confrontation with V, where they all shoot V supernaturally, manages to
body armor,
hail a bullet. I know I was getting there, but it's made to look supernatural initially. He gets up from a hail of bullets, ends up choking Creedy, and it is revealed he's wearing body armor. Thank you, Winfree. So now he's mortally wounded. He goes back to Natalie Portman's character. She puts him on the train, sends the train heading towards Parliament. All the people with the V masks that they've gotten in the mail show up to watch this thing. They take it off. Parliament blows up, fireworks. And in the alternate ending, Winfrey, I swear to God, if you interrupt me, fucking you're right out of here. In the alternate ending, which I want to talk about, V and Natalie Portman actually move to the countryside, have children, one of them born with a beauty mark.
Right. Mark, I'm going to disconnect you because this is a terrible idea.
Mute that man!
Who then grows up to become the new fascist leader in what is meant to be a franchise, V for Vendetta 2, More Vendettas.
Oh, jeez.
Not really what happened.
You need to be very grateful right about now, Mark, that you live so far away from me. Because if I was within reasonable driving distance.
I like the storyline, but I like my title better.
My joke, damn it.
V2 Vendetta Harder.
But seriously, folks, so that we can actually have a discussion about this. She sends V off in the train. The train hits Parliament blows up. There's fireworks. Last words exchanged between Natalie Portman and Finch or I Spartacus, so I'm Spartacus, and roll credits. So, one of the big complaints, first of all, let's just go around real quick. Yes, no, did you like the movie? Did you not like the movie? Ben, what were your 50 words or less thoughts on the movie?
I liked it. The two main actors that they got saved it from being probably more mediocre than it could have been. That's my biggest takeaway.
Okay. Ronnie?
I liked it. I'm a sucker for a little more action. It felt like it had a little more action in it than the, I don't know, than the book at some points. Some people may disagree with me. I like they humanized V a little more in this than in the book, than Moore did in the book. So I kind of dug on that, to a certain point. So I thought the actors I think the actors saved it from being mediocre, kind of a dull movie.
Jesse?
I did enjoy the movie. Yes, I'm gonna let Robert Winfrey handle Hugo Weaving's portrayal of V and how well that was done. Natalie Portman did a fine job. As for the rest of the actors, other than Mr. Fry, I didn't recognize, and they did. I think they did okay. I think they
How
were.
How do you not recognize Adam Hurt?
Oh, that's right, Adam Hurt, the War Doctor. My bad. I should have known.
No,
better.
No. The supreme irony of Adam Hurt as Supreme Chancellor
John.
Adam Sutler.
John
what?
Hurt.
John
Hurt.
Sorry. Okay.
Yeah, John and Williams. I get them confused sometimes. But no, the supreme irony of John Hurt being Adam Chancellor is in the, to this date, definitive and, to the best of my knowledge, only true one-to-one adaptation of Orson Welles' 1984 stars
yes.
John Hurt as the protagonist. And in this movie, he is almost literally Big Brother.
The exact opposite. good point, Winfrey. Good point. Go ahead.
Oh, okay, I thought you were done. I wanted to get Winfrey.
I am now.
Winfrey, your thoughts on the movie, and you can throw in there an extra 10 words on Hugo Weaving's portrayal of V.
I enjoyed the movie. I actually regret not seeing it in theaters when it came out. I was too put off by the marketing for this thing was, for those of you who were may remember this or who, either were too young or I imagine there's a subset of our audience that wasn't even born at the time this thing was released in theaters.
Bite your tongue.
Just an acknowledgement that some of us are old, and there's some probably young viewers. The marketing of this movie was heavily – I remember the key marketing point being that this was done by the Wachowski brothers, who were famous for The Matrix, and this is going to sound really odd considering I defended the entire trilogy for 2.5 hours with Mark Radulich on a podcast. No. I wasn't that fond of the first Matrix movie when it came out. Just generally wasn't. So their name was not a point in the movie's favor.
for me when it came to the marketing. I wound up seeing it after the fact and just regretted not seeing it in theaters for no other reason than because I did see a couple of other movies in the big Cineplex at the same time, and it didn't matter where you were in that building. You knew when Parliament blew up. And I kind of wish that I'd been able to see that. As for Hugo Weaving, yeah, tremendous. I mean, I've talked about this frequently with Sean Comer and Pat Mullen and a few other. I think Benjamin and I may have had this conversation as well. The importance of actors being able to do more, do stuff with more than just their face, acting with your body, acting with your body language, the presence that you can have, you know, things beyond what you, what is over your face. And so some very talented actors have been absolutely hamstrung by facial prosthetics. James Marsden is Cyclops, so the writing didn't help him at all, if you want a brief example of that. And here Hugo Weaving is covered head to toe for the majority of this movie and gives the best performance in the film. This was originally James Purfoy, who's a very good actor in his own right. He just had issues with wearing a mask the whole time, elements of the costume he just wasn't comfortable with. They got Weaving. Much as I like Purfoy, they absolutely traded up.
Yep.
Weaving was tremendous. You couldn't have gotten a better guy for this role. In real briefly, this might aggravate some people. I maintain this is actually the best work of Stephen Fry's career, and I hold his career in relatively high esteem.
All right. I don't want to – normally we would discuss a little bit more of the craft, but of the film, not the craft of the movie. The craft of the film, but yes. I actually want to discuss a little bit more some of the themes discussed in the movie. I want to just kick around a few ideas. You know, more talks about how this was a Bush. The Wachowskis made it a Bush era parable, sort of mirroring the paranoia in present day 2004, 2005, 2006. And the movie comes out in 2006, but, you know, I'm sure that they spent some time shooting the damn thing. So, you know, by this point, and I don't want to go off on a whole political thing, but just to give people an idea, we're in the middle of a war in Iraq, you know, and this is post mission accomplished. Not giving an opinion, it happened. The man stood there with a banner. I don't know if Abu Ghraib, I think by that point that had come out. There's a lot of problems in 2006 with the Bush era presidency, and this is not a referendum on the presidency. I don't necessarily want to talk about that, but I want to know from your guys' opinion, do you think the movie, do you think that the fact that this did hold up kind of a mirror to what was going on in the Bush presidency. Did that make the movie stronger for you? Did that not have really an effect one way or the other? And did you like the fact that that's the direction that they went in? Because I did. I'll kick off this discussion. It doesn't matter what my opinion of George Bush was or is, or what my opinion of the war was or anything else. I'm fascinated by the idea that people were very frightened of that administration, that they thought, you know, with the Patriot Act and the unlawful wiretapping and Abu Ghraib and the war, that it mirrored in a lot of ways a lot of the paranoia and a lot of the fear that was going on in the 80s. So in a way, I like the fact that they made the Vendetta, the movie, a very contemporary. I think if they had stuck with fears of Thatcherism present in the book, it wouldn't have worked as well. That's just my opinion. I think the film, to this day, and going generations even further, is something that people should watch. I think it's a very effective storytelling for society. And that goes without showing you any of my political feelings. I think it's an interesting story, and there were interesting ideas being bandied about and that the fear of what was happening was very present in the movie. What are some of your guys' thoughts? I'm going to go in reverse order this time. Please do keep in mind that we have 20 minutes of live time left, and then who knows how much of recording time would be 90, could be 59 minutes, could be 59 seconds. I don't know what it is. So be, say what you have to say, but be mindful of the clock. Go ahead.
I think it's a minor miracle that this movie aged as well as it did. I rewatched it today after I finished reading the book because I like reading. And as Mark kind of pointed out, I have very little other constraints on my time.
You don't have kids.
among other things. Yeah, no, it's the story itself, while elements of what it talks about are relatively dated, it maintains, you know, the book is still very good, in large part because I have a bit of understanding of the historical perspective. So even, you know, the fact that I never had to live through Thatcherism as an Englishman, or a lot of Thatcherism in general, given that I was born in 1985, there's still a fair amount of understanding that goes into it. With the movie, when I rewatched it, not just today, but a few months ago, just because I wanted to watch it again, one of the things I really wanted to look at was, is the movie dated because the Wachowskis and Joe McTiernan have a very particular set of agendas they would like to foist on us via their films? And to a bit of my surprise, it didn't. It is not dated. The underlying themes of governmental oppression are not at all bound by party lines. And I don't think we want to get too political here, but as a general rule, whatever your alignment happens to be on the theoretical left-right political spectrum, the extreme end of either side tends to end in fundamentally fascism, because the only way communism functions is if the government's got a gun to your head, and fascism operates with a gun to your head because that's how fascism operates. So it's really not about the Bush administration as such. It's much more about governmental overreach, governmental oppression. And that comes from, to use political parlance, either side of the aisle. And the movie manages to avoid falling into being too topical to the exclusion of rewatchability.
I would agree with that. Just as an aside, if any of you guys are into the Freakonomics podcast or have never heard of it before, they did one not that long ago. It's still on my playlist. Has the U.S. presidency become a dictatorship? And it was a fascinating listen. I listened to it today. It really goes along with what we're talking about here. I don't want to go into too many specifics because it's short of time. But it does deal with the idea of presidents from Washington till now overreaching and adding to the presidential power.
It's 8 hours on Andrew Jackson and FDR.
Oh, shut up. over the years, presidents have acquired more power for themselves, and it's a precedent that was set all the way back to the beginning, because the president's powers in the Constitution are not necessarily explicitly explained. Ben, your thoughts on the movie vis-a-vis relative to our time, thoughts about the Bush administration relative to the movie, that sort of thing. All the stuff I talked about.
Okay. I talked a little bit about this with Jesse. I'm glad a few of you guys went ahead of me on this, because you said a lot of things that I probably would have said that I really rather have not gotten into too much detail in. I have neither the inclination nor the energy right this minute to get too deep into political talk anyway. But I'll say in its original form in the original book, V for Vendetta was kind of at its heart intended to be a cautionary tale based on the political climate that Alan Moore had seen up to that point, and his interpretation and his sort of working a cautionary tale around that. And the Wachowskis basically took that idea, that concept, and worked the same story around the same concept, but in a different decade. And I think they succeeded in the storytelling aspect of it. I think they succeeded. Since it's not exactly the same, you know, political situation that, you know, you're basing the satire around, some things line up differently. But I think it works well enough to where the story did not suffer. I don't think it sort of changed, I guess, the trajectory of what Alan Moore was going for, which you kind of expect just because of what it's based around. But I don't think it hurt what the core of a lot of the characters were about. I don't think it hurt a lot of the core of what the story was trying to say. And I think both versions, the book and the adaptation of the book, came to pretty close to the same conclusion, which, like Robert said, it's kind of a minor miracle considering what they changed, how they changed it, and, you know, how they ended up circling back to, you know, from point A to as close to point B as you might expect it to have been able to come to.
Ronnie?
At my core, I absolutely abhor politics. I can't stand any of it, to be honest with you. But with that said, I didn't really correlate that with the movie with their thoughts on the Bush administration or anything like that. Mainly, probably because, I'll be honest, I block a lot of that stuff out. I know that sounds completely ignorant on my part, but it's not that I'm not informed or don't read or don't watch the news or anything like that. But when I watch a movie, I don't look at the author or not the author, but the writer or the director's personal political agenda. I set that aside, but I don't think it harmed the original story in any way with what they did with it. It actually, you know, made it a little more relevant, I guess you could say. With that said, I think they did an excellent job with it as far as that goes, but I didn't correlate that with the times that I grew up in. You know, I can remember the most of the Bush, Reagan administration as well, when, you know, all the way up through. But it's just one of those things where, I know this sounds stupid, but when I watch a movie, I watch it to be entertained. I don't correlate it with what's going on around me. But you can, but I don't most of the time.
Sure. Movies are escapism. That's a valid argument. Jesse, and then I want to talk about one specific change from the book to the movie that I think we all hate, and it needs to be discussed just to vent those feelings. So go ahead, Jess. I'm not again. Jesse! God damn it. While we're waiting for Jesse, Skype, and Bog Talk Radio to finally get along, let me go ahead and I'll move ahead, and if we ever get Jesse back, I'll double back. It'll be a little awkward, but that's fine. Awkward, since it's boy, that's Radulich in Croatian. All right. I want to talk about one of the changes in the book. We talked about this offline, and it bears repeating. So I'm watching this movie, and I'll just give you my take on it. I'm watching the movie, and I'm really into it. I'm getting a lot of different things, a lot of stuff to talk about, you know, the contemporariness of the time, the detective story, them trying to piece the thing together, this revenge tale. It's a very layered, complex story. I'm really enjoying it. And then V says something along the lines to Evie, who's played by Natalie Portman, "I've fallen in love with you." And I had one of those moments where I just wanted to throw everything off my desk and turn the movie on. I could not stand it. I don't know if it's a failure of direction, a failure of writing, but it came across to me like studio notes. You know, it just like executive, like they got dailies. They looked at the footage and went, why does this not have a love story? Can we get a love story going here? You know, a bit of a love story in the book. It's kind of a father-daughter thing. Oh, fuck that. You know, this is America, goddammit, and we need to have a love story. Can we change the ending? Can we have a happy ending? No, sir. That really takes the whole tone of the whole thing. All right, but just make him fall in love. Can we do that? Ugh. It took me right out of the movie. I felt it was a failure of movie itself, a failure of directing, failure of the script, and I feel like it didn't service the character at all. I almost didn't make it to the end. There was only 13 minutes left, but I almost didn't make it to the end of the movie. And it passed over quickly enough that I got over it, you know, just the same. But oh my God, was that hard. It's the worst part of the movie, and we're talking a movie that high, holy shit, he just said he loved her for no good reason. And we're back again. It really derails the movie scene, almost to the point of unwatchability. And maybe I'm being a bit hyperbolic. You guys have a minute to think about that while we have Jesse who's back.
Hello.
Or is he? Oh, good. Jesse, well, everybody is coming up with rational explanations for why they went this way, and they're going to tell me all about it. You tell me your thoughts on the previous topic.
Oh, yes. I was saying, by the way, 2 years, Blog Talk Radio, nothing's changed, by the way, just to let everybody know. I'm right there with Ronnie, one of the least political guys you'll probably know. Watch the movie. I certainly didn't get any overtone of, political power or political party was in power at that point in time. What I did get watching the movie was, you know, how interestingly touchy the subject of terrorism would have been 5 years outside of 9/11. One of the things that really struck me was like, man, just imagine sitting there watching this happen, and, you know, you're 5 years outside of one of the worst terrorist attacks in our nation's history, and you have to root for this guy. Quite a difficult situation to be put in. You know, now we're 15 years out. Obviously, we've learned as we've come a little bit further forward. Doesn't make the situation that less shocking. It's just that, you know, it's become a part of our history and a part of our culture so much that watching it, you know, 10 years after it's been released may not hold that much of a shock value, but may not hold that, may not touch your heartstrings as much as it may have back then. So, but as for politically wise, I was not watching this movie. I watched this movie Saturday. I think it was the second time I watched it. And I was certainly not, you know, other than just watching the oppressive government in action, that is the main thing I got from the story. So I don't believe they really, you know, hammered down that fact. And Mark, you probably recognize stuff like that a little bit easier than I would because one of the first podcasts on this network, I believe, was a political podcast. Could be wrong on that, but please.
You're right.
Okay, so you know, I mean, you can see that stuff easy. And did it feel to you that it was that politically charged and that representative of what was going on at the time? Did you say that it was?
you know how many movies I've seen with fascist governments and somebody, you know, whose aim is to take them down through, killing people and blowing up buildings? This was not an original concept. It was nicely done, and I enjoyed it. There are interesting elements of it that I have not seen in those kinds of movies. But overall, you have a wronged and angry man who looks around at the world and says, something is not right here on night, and I am compelled, for whatever the reasons are, in this case, revenge, to do something about it. And, you know, and on the other side of this, you've got this Orwellian nightmare. And if you don't think that 1984 got brought up constantly during the Bush administration, then you were not listening.
Stupid.
So for me, I thought that I didn't think about it until after the movie was over, as far as getting into that part of it and sort of, you know, reading the background of the movie and everything. I'm like, okay, no, I see all that now. It makes sense. As I was just watching the movie, was, you know, man takes down fascist government, film at 11.
Yeah.
Very well done. Okay, so back to V and I Love You. Am I wrong? Am I wrong, guys? Do I just not have a heart, or am I on the right page? Ben, talk to me. Tell me what's going on.
You're not wrong. Personally, for me, up to that point, I mean, hints were dropped, allusions were made more so than in the book. In the book, like you said, it was a much more, you know, sort of father-daughter dynamic between the two main characters, to the point where, like I said, early on in the book, Evie is at one point convinced that V is her father, which he flatly denies. And she's, you know, she comes to the, you know, she sort of accepts that by the time the story's over. And all I'll say, and like you said, you mentioned like studio notes, and that's kind of what it felt like to me. It felt like it was, you know, every once in a while, you know, some dummy from Warner Brothers felt the need to justify his own existence and pipe in and say, you know, there's not enough romance in this movie. Do something about that. But the thing is, you could kind of tell it was done so half-assedly and so half-heartedly, and it was so tacked on that I didn't, me personally, like, it didn't even have a chance for me to hate it. It's such a non-factor in the entire movie that it's just so easily forgettable for me. And it doesn't, in that way, it doesn't ruin the movie for me at all. It doesn't do anything to the movie at all because there's not enough weight given to it for it to do anything.
I don't know. It's like, I'm reminded, second Family Guy reference of the night, everyone. I'm reminded of a bit in Family Guy where, like, in the middle
like
of
the mug pit.
Third reference. the one that I'm coming up with was in the middle of whatever it is they're doing, all of a sudden the Fox logo comes up and you see an advertisement for another show, and they do it again. They do it like two or three times. About the third time, Stewie's like, can we finish one show before we start getting into the next show? Finish this candy bar that you're eating, then move on to the next candy bar. And that's kind of what it felt like to me. It was just like, in the middle of this movie, we have, you know, or at the very end of this movie, where, you know, we're racing towards this move, but we all want to see Parliament blow up. That's the big payoff here. That's where this gets going. And there's this, all of them, this huge distraction. I love you, Evie. Ugh. You know, we're shoving buddies. You know, two guys just at each other. That's the thing in Family Guy. Now, I was, you know, with a Martin church, the way to describe it.
I've got an unrelated tangent on this. I would like everybody to have their say about this particular subject. When that's done, I've got something else I need to say about this movie and Natalie Portman in particular. But just you know, bookmark that for, you know, when everybody's had their say.
It'll be the next thing we talk about. Winfree. I love you, Winfree. See, it's weird, right?
It's weird when you say it.
Only because I know you're a liar.
What a twist.
No, it doesn't need to be there. I don't hate the fact that... How do I phrase this? He actually does profess his love for her right before he dies in the book, but the whole dynamic between them in the book is very different from what it is in the movie. I appreciate the fact that if they're going to have him do stupid dialogue, at least it's on his deathbed. I mean, look, if I'm shot 30 times and I've just taken down a government, I think at that point I'm allowed to say something somewhat stupid. From a directorial standpoint, no, it's thrown in there. It's not even explained properly because they tried so hard. Like, I think I agree with you that it's a studio note. If he had simply followed up I fell in love with you with, I mean, he spent, by his own admission, 20 years preparing for this event. Suddenly he has a human contact with humanity again. Okay, he forms a slightly unhealthy attachment. I'll buy that. They just didn't explain it in any sense other than... And, I mean, I love you has so many different connotations. There's different types of love. This is all well documented.
Yeah.
And I need to correct myself very briefly because I'm an idiot. When I mentioned earlier 1984, I erroneously said that Orson Welles had written it. It's George Orwell, and I will break one of my fingers in penance for being that freaking stupid.
I didn't even notice. I mean, I knew what you meant.
Hey, I somehow dovetailed into calling Travis Brown Brendan Schaub on the last Ground and Pound show and just completely escaped my mind.
I know you don't do drugs. Have you really been hitting yourself in the head?
No, not as much. No, come on. How many weeks? I need to do it more, Mark. We haven't done a movie review in like a month. My brain is missing the trauma. but... Anyway, my point, they tried to throw it in there. I mean, his attachment to her is displayed relatively well. I don't like some of the changes they made to the Evie character for the movie. However, I understand it. My biggest gripe with the movie and the changes they made, honestly, it's made very, very clear in the book that this particular fascist government, in the tenets of certain other fascists, such as the National Socialist Party, better known as the Nazis, for those of you unaware of that, they're racist. A great number of the people that they executed in these concentration camps, like V was held in, were black or Pakistani, or, you know, they make a big point of that. In this movie, they go out of their way to fixate on, well, it's the homosexuals we don't like. And it's really it bothers me in the sense that I liked when they made a good point in the book about it being everyone. You know, it wasn't just, they didn't single anything out. They actually changed the slogan of the government. In the movie, it's strength through unity, unity through faith. In the book, it's strength through purity and purity through faith. The fact that they moved a little bit closer and made a much bigger, I mean, Valerie's still gay in the book, and that's still kind of your touch point, your story of your not quite survivor story, your Diary of Anne Frank, if you will. But the fact that they went out of their way with the rest of the government to make it more more homophobia as opposed to just irrationally trying to control the sum total of their area of influence diminishes aspects of the story in a relatively significant way. And it really shouldn't be surprising considering the Wachowski sisters wrote this thing.
Real quick, before
that's
before
not
we
a
did,
misstep. I believe they've both come out as identifying as female.
Super.
I knew one of them had.
Before we get
but
to Ron,
I didn't know both.
There's, the Nazis, coming for this and that. Are allusions to Nazism in as far as reaching out the weak and creating a society of the strong. It's not a new concept. There's a poem, I don't know if you guys have ever heard it, probably mispronounced the person's name. Martin Niemöller firstly came to the socialists, and it basically goes, firstly came to the socialists, I did not speak out, I was a socialist, then he came to the trade unionists, I did not speak out, trade unionists, then they came to the Jews, this goes on and on. At the end, it says, then they came for me, and there was no one left to speak. There's been different versions of this, like, the same idea. First, they came for this, and they came for that, and finally, they came for me. And I think that's fairly well represented. I thought it was well represented. I think there was a little bit of focus on the gay, but there are definitely black people and weirdos and, you know, whatever being loaded on and off trucks.
Actually a specific scene in the movie that I wish they had, and Ben talked about a few of these, a specific scene in the novel, when the inspector goes to this camp, Lark Hill, and doses himself with LSD. I really do wish they'd represented elements of that whole scenario better in the book, in the movie, because there's one in particular that the first time I read the book kind of, for some reason, punched me in the guts a little bit. As he's hallucinating, like you do when you're on LSD, he sees... I wouldn't know. I don't imbibe, but I have anecdotal evidence. As he's going through this camp, because he believes that the only way he's going to catch V is to get inside his head, and this is an important part on that step. The drugs aren't necessary. Any profiler will tell you that, but he is trying to get inside this guy's head. And as he's in this camp, he sees, again, he hallucinates a bunch of the people who were there, some gay, some Indian, some black, and he laments what was lost by the way they behaved towards him, by their extermination. And it's a really poignant scene in the novel, and I really wish they'd been able to work that into the movie somehow, in no small part because Stephen Ray is more than a capable enough actor to have done that whole kind of emotional journey justice.
I would have just shown it. I think I would have had him go there and, you know, and just have and just do it in flash. Fight shot on his face, flash, a shot of Pakistan in black, back to his face, gaze back to his face, whatever. Just keep going back and forth and, you know, and just seeing snippets of things that went on there around him. There didn't need to be a rational explanation for somehow why he was seeing these glasses. But it doesn't matter. It's cinema. It's film.
His drug use in the book serves a very different purpose.
Well, I don't want him to do drugs in this one.
I don't disagree. I'm not disagreeing with you. I'm just pointing out that the hallucination from... I agree with you as far as setting it up properly. Could have been... you don't need hallucinogens in a visual medium to get across that point.
Right.
You're watching Across the Universe, in which case you better be high.
Just show it, and now you pull the story of Lark Hill through these flashes, the audience is with you and gets an idea of the horrendousness of this government. All right, Ronnie and then Jesse, and then and then Ben had one more thing, and then we can start wrapping things up.
Go, Ronnie.
What? What? Okay.
I love you, Ron.
right back at you, pal. So I got caught up in thinking about and looking up the Wachowskis real quick. What was the question again?
we were debating the merits of the romantic subplot. It's not actually a subplot, but
yeah,
the point.
Yeah, I'm so
sorry. Right before he dies.
Yeah, I got lost. I got lost. I apologize, but going back to what I said that they tried to humanize V a little more. In my opinion, they really in his mannerisms and his speech and things like that. Of course, it's a book. When I'm reading it, I read him more as a focused, monotone kind of not monotone, but a focused person. But in this, he's a little more whimsical at points. I'm thinking back when. He's cooking breakfast and the movie and things like that. Especially the movie scene, you kind of see it coming at that point of them, you know, falling for each other. Because if you look at his mannerisms, the way he's sitting like a nervous teenager next to a girl that he really likes watching a movie. You know, the only thing he's missing is him trying to hold her hand while they're on, you know, sitting on the couch, you know, inching his hand closer to him. That's what I got out of it.
the hole in the bottom.
Yeah, the whole pillow. Oh, I wasn't doing that for her. But,
and that's how Mark met his first ex-wife.
But it's American cinema. You're going to have to throw that element into it because you want your audience to stay connected, and they believe that's the only way, you know, sometimes that you can stay connected with a character is if he has that human element of falling in love once again, you know, falling in love with whoever he has with him at that point. And, you know, being through the traumatic situations he's been in, that he latched onto the first person, you know, that he connected with, and you know, there's a whole lot of psychological elements that go with that. But I don't think it detracted anyway. It was definitely a grown moment of, you know, I've fallen in love with you. I'm like, ah, just blow something up, man. Just get it over with.
Go do some stabbing.
Just stab somebody, blow something up, and get it over with. But I don't think it really took away, but it was definitely a groaner of a moment for me.
I'll go ahead and weigh in with my defense of it, which Ronnie may have touched on. I'm gonna go ahead and post a picture as soon as I can find your guys' post here earlier. But, okay, she kisses V on the mask. Okay. Now, one of the things that I saw was just how weird that was on some of the YouTube stuff and the research I was doing. Like, why, you know, you imagine how just strange that would be to walk up to somebody and kiss them on their mask. Okay. Now, here's my defense. Evie has become a lover of the, I would say she was on her way to becoming a lover of the reason V was fighting, and her kiss on the mask was a representation of her accepting the values that V stood for, and I can't remember if that particular part. I'm pretty sure that happened, you know, as things started coming towards the end, where the whole love interest was at. But, you know, that's the only thing I could think of is that it symbolized her love and her acceptance for what V stood for, which was, you know, his side of things, the anarchy, and showing the progress that she had made from what she was starting all the way up into that one point. Now, that's the only defense that I could come up with it, because that's the only part that I really got the whole, you said I love you. When did that happen? Because I really honestly don't remember him saying that. Does he say that as
right
he's dying?
Right before he dies. He says, I fell in love.
Those are literally his last words in the comic.
His last words are, after she says, I don't want you to die, he just kind of quasi-sardonically says, you know, that's the most beautiful thing you could have said to me. Now, when did she kiss him? Because I know that happened. That caught my eye.
Right before he takes off for his final confrontation with Creedy.
Okay. All right. Now, right there, a kiss is obviously going to show. That right there was the point where I was like, oh, man, we're kind of getting into this. I don't remember that happening. That didn't happen in the book, did it? I certainly don't remember
that
happening.
Yeah, it
did. It did?
I am 90% sure that, yeah, there is a scene where she kisses the mask.
Okay. Yep. All right.
I always thought it was because that she got a good look at his hands and didn't want to, you know, knew there was the reason he wore it.
Well, the guy was
he
should have died.
Right?
The reality, you get third-degree burns or, you know, even second-degree burns over that much of your body, you should die.
Jesse, and love you like a brother, but the idea that you have a woman who's going to show someone that she supports his ideals and is with him through kissing almost makes it worse. It, like, it took whatever I was feeling about it, and it, you've now made that even worse.
Well, that's the way I took it, Mark Radulich.
No, I know, and that's fine. But I mean, you've made me hate it more. Is my point. I'm not necessarily disagreeing with you.
I hear you.
The idea that all the woman can do to show someone appreciation and support is through something of a sexual or romantic or intimate nature. And I think you're right to a degree, and that's why it makes it even worse, is we've now reduced an interesting character to yet another Americanized all women can do in movies sex on.
Oh, come on, man. Now, you can't sit there and tell me that, you know, I have no doubt in my mind that you absolutely love your wife 100%. There's probably something that she has done in your life that's moved you so much that you had to kiss her. That is what happened here. She was so moved and, you know, and just absolutely, you know, her mind was blown by what was going on, that the only thing that she had left to do was to put a smoocheroo on the guy.
Feel like there's not a snap of an orange.
All right, I'm done. As for the I love you, I don't even remember it, so whatever.
No one does. If Mark had seen this movie 3 days ago and wasn't going to talk about it on a podcast, it would not still be in his mind. That's how inconsequential it is. That's not an insult to Mark. That's just how little it means to the film.
Mm-hmm.
That bothered me on so many levels. All right. It hurt my soul.
You'll weep silently as we go through the plugs.
Set women back at least 20 years. All right. Ben, you wanted to add one more thing, and then I have a final thought.
Yeah, I had one last thing that I wanted to bring up. It's worth mentioning. I don't know how big a fan of Natalie Portman as an actress any of you are. I happen to be a very big fan of her. I happen to be a very big fan of her as an
actress. Hey, man, she was dope in the
prequels. Was that?
Dope in the prequels?
I'm getting to that. Hold on. That's basically what
Shut your mouth, Mark.
To talk about.
Natalie Portman was the bomb in Phantom.
Mark, your history's greatest monster.
he's up there.
Okay. This V for Vendetta is the movie that Natalie Portman did immediately after the Star Wars prequels. You've seen, you know, back from, you know, when she was 12 years old, you've seen movies that she's been in. In 2004, she got nominated for an Oscar for Closer. She's, you know, she's good. She was actually, you know, and I don't know anybody's particular opinion of this, but I found her particularly horrible in the Star Wars prequels. And then this is the movie that she immediately does after those movies, and then within the next 5 years, she's got an Oscar for Black Swan, which is a movie that I absolutely love. It is a testament, I think, because the common thread in here, you know, the common denominator here is I think it is a testament to just how shit of a director George Lucas was in terms of dealing with actors, where Natalie Portman can give that horrible a performance in three consecutive movies in a franchise, go from being pretty consistently good before that, terrible in those movies, and then on to something like V for Vendetta immediately after that and being an Academy Award winner within the next 5 years. I think it is a testament to just how shit of a director George Lucas is when it comes to dealing with actors. And that was really kind of all the proof that I needed.
This movie's integral to the rehabilitation of her career. There's a reason that her, Ewan McGregor, and Liam Neeson are the only ones that came out of those movies with anything approaching the ability to continue working in the field after those movies.
I think I hear.
And
the other
end of the spectrum is Jake Lloyd.
I hear you guys saying. My only question is, so love has blinded you?
I feel like that's a reference to something that I don't know.
It is. Nobody finished that bit.
I have no idea.
God in heaven, nobody, if anybody know, I'm pretty sure I know the next line in that bit, and I'm not giving it to you, Mark. I'm not giving you the satisfaction.
I want to so bad, but I'm afraid Winfrey will hold me down and murder me.
Ben moment. Wait, we got an angry Ben moment finally. It's awesome.
Oh, Ben.
Angry Ben moments. Love them.
That's not anger. That's fear. Not giving him the satisfaction. It's not going to happen.
This is a great moment of dialogue. Only because I'm so in love with you. The love has blinded you.
So he just finishes the bit by himself anyway.
he's gotta do it somehow. Nobody's gonna
feel like
I
need to quote
Leon the Professional just to erase that particular bit of intellectual bile from the world.
Imagine this is a greatly written comedy. It's so awesome. I mean, pratfalls galore. You know, Samuel L. Jackson going out a window. It's great. You know, you've got to laugh at it. In any case.
No, I don't.
I pulled it all up on YouTube, and I was going to play it, but I'm not going to, for fear of my life.
To Ben's point, I have said for years now that George Lucas isn't a director. He's a special effects technician. And I think he has some interesting ideas in terms of story, but he needs a team of people around him to pull those stories out and make it into a feature. He's not able to do it, and he certainly doesn't know how to direct people. I mean, I think the man is like a functional, you know, autistic when it comes to people. He doesn't know how to deal with them. I honestly think that if George Lucas had just kind of produced the prequels, that here's some ideas, now let me give it to a competent writer, and let's get a director who actually knows how to deal with people, we would have gotten much. I think we could have gotten what he was getting at, but a much better told story and much better performances. But even the actors will tell you, George didn't give them any direction. It was just sort of stay the line, do shit in front of a green screen. So I don't blame Natalie Portman for that. As far as this, I mean, it's hard to say how good or bad the direction is. I didn't find a lot of missteps in a lot of the performances. I didn't see a lot of incompetence in the set pieces, you know, or the action sequences. So I'm having a bit of difficulty saying this director is either good, bad, or indifferent. This seemed like a competent motion picture. I'm not entirely sure how much direction she got.
Officially,
you know,
sorry, go ahead.
No, go.
Well, officially, James McTeague is the credited director of this movie. The Wachowskis wrote the adaptation of Moore's book, and apparently they were second unit directing a lot of this movie. So I think it's kind of given rise to the idea of, you know, just how much of this movie was James McTeague and how much of it was possibly the Wachowskis directing.
McTeague's follow-up films don't lend him a whole lot of credibility when it comes to this movie being
exactly
uniquely his.
Yeah,
we're talking about the man
like,
responsible for Ninja Assassin.
Yeah, it's which the Wachowskis also like produced, didn't they? Like,
probably.
I think so. Anyway, the point is, you know, there's I don't know how much speculation, but I know at the time there was a little bit of, you know, questioning, you know, whether or not, you know, portions of this movie may or may not have been, if not ghost directed by the Wachowskis, then at least kind of by proxy through James McTeague.
Kind of the same way that Kurt Russell actually directed Tombstone.
Yeah, or, you know, the whole popular, like, you know, Spielberg-directed Poltergeist kind of thing. I don't know how true that is, but if it was revealed to be true, it wouldn't surprise me at all.
All right, Jesse, any final thoughts, film, versus the book, in general, with the discussion, anything left unsaid, any burning desires?
Well, the only thing really that I want to say is that I'm very pleased that I had the opportunity to read the book. And this is the first time I've ever read V for Vendetta. I think I watched the movie a long time ago, never had the opportunity to read the actual source material. And I was very pleased. So if I'll go ahead and tout out there to definitely pick up the book if you can and give it a read. It holds up to today, I think. Just it was mentioned that there are some dated references, which it does kind of get a little bit and it does feel a little dated because we're talking early 80s when this thing came out. But the overall theme of this book is very relevant to what you see happening today. So pick it up. And if you get it, as for the movie itself, you know, compare, contrast, I enjoyed the movie as well. I had a great time watching the movie. I watched it in my kitchen over on Saturday, and I was glued to the screen. It's kind of hard to sit on a kitchen seat and watch a movie and not want to get out of there and go do something else. And I was hooked. So very good book. Probably one of the best that we've covered so far.
Ronnie Adams, Burning Desires.
Yes. No, I agree with Jesse, and this being one of my favorite Alan Moore books, more so than like From Hell and a few others. But I think the movie holds up well, and you know, holds up to the legacy of the book really well. And I enjoyed both. Hugo Weaving really brought V to life for me, and that's one of the things I really enjoyed most about the movie.
Benjamin Cologne. Can we get more Angry Ben? An Angry Ben Burning Desires?
You can't, don't make him become Angry Ben. That just happens naturally.
Oh,
yeah,
sorry.
I don't go looking for things to be angry at. You just kind of like push him in front of me like a deer in front of my car. this book is tremendous. It kind of, you know, it's an emotional favorite of mine. It's a sentimental favorite of mine. It's well written. It's well drawn. Like I had the privilege of meeting David Lloyd once. I have a sketch that he did in crayon of V hanging on my wall. It is very special to me. I love virtually everything about this story, and it's a big influence on me as a writer and an artist as well. Can't say enough good things about it. It's great.
Robert Winfree, hit it.
This is easily the best adapted Alan Moore work. I don't think it's very close. I actually enjoy Watchmen. Wasn't on that podcast, but I enjoy Watchmen as a movie. I think this is the best adaptation of Alan Moore's work. Period. Full stop. Hands down. Walk away from the table. Potential argument for the season of Constantine we got on NBC a couple 2 years ago? Because Hellblazer is, I believe, done originally by Alan Moore. So I'll hear that argument potentially, but other than that, this is the best. It's easily the best movie. And I like both. This is one of those instances where, you know, we talk about which is better. I don't think there's a better here. You might prefer one over the other based on, you know, what you enjoy as a consumer. But the book is well written. It's well drawn. It's well paced. There's no real complaints with it. The movie is well shot, well-written, well-acted, competently directed, very few complaints, again, apart from random tacked-on love interest. This is some of the best of Moore's work. It's certainly the best of his kind of standalone stuff in a lot of ways. I mean, if you get into some of his serialized runs, then the discussion changes completely. But as a, you know, as a graphic novel, it stands. It's still good. I could still read it easily.
And the movie holds up very, very well. It's still very interesting. The action is still good. It's a, again, well-made and relatively intelligent movie in the sense that interesting things are going on screen the whole time. There's no pointless explosions.
All right. I think I've talked a lot during this podcast. I think I've been funny. I don't really have any other closing thoughts other than I really like the movie. I fell asleep on it the first time. That's not a measure of the movie itself. I was just tired. during my first time, that whole period is pretty hazy. So I'm going to throw it over to you, Jesse, to take us on out.
All right. Well, let's do it. We'll go ahead and get into plugs here. I'll go ahead and plug here for the Source Material Podcast. Check it out on Mondays. We're in the midst of He-Man month, mini comics, the He-Man September mini comic spectacular, something like that. I can't remember what it is. It's midnight. But anyway, we just got done with the third episode. It's only about 20 minutes long. You can check it out. We're talking about, I believe this past week was Stinkor and Hordak Slime Pit. Those were a couple stories that I picked. Now, this coming Monday is our fourth and final mini comic spectacular. Should be about a half hour long, where Justin Thomas gets on there, gives us another couple stories. At Stiznarchy on Twitter, you can also follow the show at SourceMatCast on Twitter. Go ahead and give the Radulich and Broadcasting Facebook page a like. You can stay up on top of all the great podcasts that are out there. We're not going to bombard you with a bunch of stuff. Give it a like. If there's a podcast coming up, all we do is notify you and then share a funny picture along with it. That's usually about it. So I want to thank everybody out there that's listened tonight. If you guys enjoyed this podcast, please, please, please give some thought about sharing it and letting somebody else know about it. Maybe you know somebody that really enjoys Alan Moore's work, somebody that really enjoys V for Vendetta. Maybe somebody enjoys the Wachowskis and their films. Please, by all means, let them know this podcast is out there. And podcasts are great. Fun. Beats talk radio to a pulp. We're gotta love niche radio. Other than that, I'll go ahead and I'll let Ronnie Adams and then Winfree and then Benjamin J. Cologne and Mark, you can plug whatever you got there, man. Please, by all means, go ahead there, Ronnie Adams. What you got to plug, man?
Sweet. We actually, I'm as well as being on Source Material, I have a show called Screaming Boy Podcast. It is a nerd culture type podcast where we just discuss, topics of the day and mostly stuff that we like, that pop culture references, things like that. We have several shows that are in the can, ready to be released. Will be so in the next couple of days. As for past shows, we just got done with episode 6 with Josh Calanders. Now we did the first three issues of Civil War II, Marvel's newest arc, and we'll be continuing that later on as it goes. We did Never Ending Story. It's just released. We covered CM Punk's disastrous UFC debut, and in the same show, we discussed the hand grenade of a cell phone, the Samsung Note 7.
Uh-huh.
So all kinds of stuff. We're all over the board. It's been a lot of fun. You can catch us on iTunes, Stitcher, TuneIn, and the Radulich and Broadcasting Network. You can find us on Twitter at Screaming Boy PR. You can also find us, Screaming Boy PR.
Public relations.
relations. You can catch us on Instagram, Screaming Boy Podcast. You can just look us up on Facebook by typing in the same thing, Screaming Boy Podcast, www.screamingboy.com. Reach out to us, listen to us, share. And that's pretty much it.
All right. Robert Winfree, sir.
How have you not been offered a ton of money for the Screaming Boy domain yet?
I don't know. But it is ours.
They're crossing their fingers and hoping it happens.
I mean, I just have to imagine.
If somebody offers it, I mean, you know, I'm willing. I'm willing to take some and
they will be
know,
considered.
Entertain some offers.
Yeah. Yeah, there you go.
All right. You can find me most Sunday evenings hosting the 411 Ground and Pound radio show, a weekly show devoted to the wide, wacky, wonderful world of mixed martial arts. This Saturday, if you're interested in MMA as a sport, in the MMA zone of 411mania.com, I will be covering UFC Fight Night 95? 5 or 6? 5. Cyborg versus Landsberg. UFC's returning to Brasilia, Brazil. Not a bad card, actually, all things considered. This week we will be reviewing that and previewing UFC Fight Night 96, Lineker versus Dodson. I am very much looking forward to that. Because John Lineker and John Dodson, despite being bantamweights, are heavy punchers and love to throw down. So, really good main event. This Tuesday, Mark Radulich and I are back on the review horse. We will be reviewing the Magnificent Seven remake, and I will likely talk about more unnecessary explosions. Because I've seen a few more extended trailers, and yeah, this one could be a rough one, folks. So Mark and I will be reviewing that, again, Tuesday at 9:30 Eastern Time here on the Radulich and Broadcasting Network. And I will be back next week as we wrap this up by looking at From Hell, because I just want an excuse to yell at Johnny Depp.
All right, Benjamin J. Cologne, my man, thanks for joining us tonight. Please plug your stuff.
Hey, thanks for having me and allowing me a forum to talk about V for Vendetta and to yell at Mark for quoting the Star Wars prequels. Don't do it again. Okay, plugs. As always, as ever, I write, draw, self-publish a comic called Soul Exodus. You can find it through my website, soulexo.com, through my Facebook page, facebook.com/soulexo, through Twitter, at SoulExo Comic, SOULEXO. I will be in about 2 weeks' time at New York Comic Con once again. My table number is 1269. This is October 6th through the 9th. I will be selling copies of Soul Exodus. I will be selling a lot of my sketch cover art because I have a big old long box and it's almost full of blank covers. Some of them have art on them, some of them don't. I will be accepting commissions while I'm there. I'll be doing as much drawing as humanly possible in 4 days, and hopefully I'll be having a good time of it. One other thing, Soul Exodus is also available digitally through drivethroughcomics.com. If you are of the inclination to read comics on your tablet or other mobile device, you can get them for download. You can purchase them for digital download at drivethroughcomics.com, and I encourage you to do so. For private commissions, individual commissions, I'm always up for that. You can hit me up either through Twitter or email me at bjc@soulexo.com. I also do artwork for a little podcast that some of you may have heard of called Long Road to Ruin. And if you haven't, I completely understand. great bunch of guys. I wouldn't know any of you without it.
Mm-hmm.
Mark Radulich, Sean Comer. I will be back on that particular horse right around Harry Potter time, I believe, which is coming up. If Mark wants to give a date, then he can tell him what.
I thought you had some non-related artwork for Hannibal Lecter.
That too. See, I'm forgetting things already. I've got.
I'm really looking forward to what you do for our review of the Hannibal Lecter movies.
Well, I haven't decided if I'm going to do something wholly original for that. I may, but I also have a particular piece of Silence of the Lambs artwork that I did kind of just for shits and giggles that I'll probably include that I believe you probably already seen, but we'll see. I may try to surprise you guys.
we'll see what happens. There's that. Then, you know, I'll be back right around Harry Potter time, most likely, which means I've got about 8 movies to watch to get ready for that and get me in the right frame of mind. It'll be quite a chore, but also probably a lot of fun. And I'll be right back here next week, I guess, because apparently there's a need from hell, an undertaking that I have tried two separate times previously and have not been able to complete it. I've had this book for over like 5 or 6 years. I'm trying my best to read it as comprehensively as I can. It's a good book. I enjoy it very much, but I said earlier today to Robert, it's denser than Scottish fog.
That's about right.
And about 1/5 of it is bibliography. That's how much research Alan Moore did in creating this book. It is probably the most densely researched thing that he's ever done, possibly up until the novel that he just released, which was edited down from like I think something like 1 million words. Yeah. But, you know, that should be, you know, I got a lot on my plate for the foreseeable future. But, you know, yeah, next week from hell, I will try to, you know, between me and Jesse, we'll probably try to do something to rein in Robert's sometimes irrational hatred of Johnny Depp.
That'll be
it's
fun.
It's not irrational.
If such a thing is possible to be able to do.
It's very well-founded hatred.
Fine.
I will appreciate the counterpoint. I have no problem with people who like Johnny Depp. And when my hatred strays into the irrationality, I hope people inform me that I'm no longer basing my criticism on something valid.
I actually haven't seen the movie version of From Hell just yet. I'm trying to finish the book.
I envy you. I have to rewatch it before. I've seen it once. I have to rewatch it before next week. I'm about halfway through the book, and I have a digital copy this time around. I struggle reading digital the same way I read print. So. I looked for a physical copy because I probably could have knocked that out in a day.
It's a little bit tricky finding it. I mean, it's not impossible. It's available online.
I would have had to order it on Amazon and waited for a delivery, and it just wasn't worth it. Not on the time crunch, and I don't feel like owning it. Because at this point, I'm relatively convinced that From Hell is not merely a reference to the famous letter penned by Jack the Ripper, but actually the metaphysical location of this story, and Alan Moore is warning us about it.
Oh, interesting.
And that we can consider that a teaser for next week.
Mark Radulich.
Funny story, I had my hands on a physical copy of From Hell, but I hurt my back trying to read it.
I was reading in bed, and it fell on my face, knocked me out. All right, Mark Radulich, you still awake?
Yes.
All right.
I was trying to, as you guys were making silly jokes, I was trying to come up with a line from Revenge of the Sith that I could quote, but I honestly was blank.
You want to send Benjamin off in a pissed off mood. That's wrong of you.
All right. Couple of things. We do a little podcast on here called The Metal Hammer of Doom, where we recently covered the new Mercuria album and the new single Viva Presidente from. Go ahead, give that a listen. It was great fun. Next week, we are reviewing on Wednesday, assuming Coop is off. Every Time I Die, Low Teens, currently on Spotify, if you wanted to check that out. Last week, Friday, I did a little thing called the Diet Diary. Pat Mullen was on. We both told our stories. For those of you who have given me feedback on it, I appreciate you, and I will continue to be brutally honest about myself. It's the only way to get this done. I had my weigh-in today. I will talk about it tomorrow. Probably sometime during the afternoon if I can get my son to take a fucking nap. done with him being away. I'll be in the middle of like, so I'm really struggling with the daddy tickle me. All right. So I'm tied to a chair and, you know, watch Paw Patrol. Maybe I'll get it done that way. But, now I'm planning on doing another diet diary, tomorrow, which would be Friday the 23rd. As Robert said, we have a review next week. The week after that, we are going to be reviewing Deepwater Horizon and Marvel's and Netflix's Luke Cage. So look for those as well. Yes, November is Harry Potter month. Almost every week in the month of November, starting November 3rd, we will be looking at two Harry Potter movies, with the exception of the week of Thanksgiving. And as far as Long Road to Ruin goes, that comes back in October. And as we alluded to before, we'll be doing two shows on the four Hannibal Lecter movies.
I need to apologize again to everyone. Mark asked if we should consider Hannibal Rising part of the collective, and I said yes for the sake of completionism. I didn't realize that he was going to take me seriously enough to include it. I apologize to everyone who has to listen to us talk about that, and to Mark and Sean, who I don't believe have seen it yet.
Uh-oh.
It's going to be exciting. So, yeah.
I'd rather talk about the television show than that movie.
Oh, yeah.
Our horror movie for this year at Long Road to Ruin will be the Hannibal Lecter series. Got one picked out for next year already. Want to hear it? I got somewhere.
Yeah.
Right here. Where is it? What's next year's horror movie? Have my notes all around. Here we go. Next year's horror movie franchises from Dusk Till Dawn.
It's pretty good.
Uh oh.
Yeah, no reaction there.
Sex machine.
the crotch pistol.
Oh, man.
I can't take that pistol seriously because the transference of energy and heat would just make it unusable.
Thank you, Mr. Wizard.
You and your gun science.
I can't take that that pistol seriously because it pops up from his crotch.
All right. I'm going to take this out. Thank you, Jesse. I'm sorry you had all the technical problems you had tonight. Thank you, Benjamin, for calling in. Ronnie, Winfrey, love you guys. We'll see you next week, Thursday, our last installment of Alan Moorman, From Hell, the book, the movie, the play, the novel, the Broadway musical, the whole nine yards, everything about it, and a little Pirates of the Caribbean talk, because, you know, Johnny Depp. All right, so here's The Simpsons talking some Alan Moore. For everybody here at the Radulich and Broadcasting Network, we will be safe and be here.
Look at all these alternative comic book creators. Alan Moore, Art Spiegelman, Dan Klaus. I really identified with the girls in Ghost World. They made me feel like I wasn't so alone.
Yeah, whatever. Do you know anyone who works at Batman? Because I really want to draw Batman. I'm awesome at utility belts. Check these out. This is where the Batman keeps his money, in case he has to take the bus.
Mm-hmm. Alan Moore, you wrote my favorite issues of Radioactive Man.
Oh, really? So you like that I made your favorite superhero a heroin-addicted jazz critic who's not radioactive?
I don't read the words. I just like when he punches people. How do you make his costume stick so close to his muscles? Mr. Moore, will you sign my DVD of Watchmen Babies? Which of the babies is your favorite?
You see, what those bloody corporations do, they take your ideas and they suck them. Suck them like leeches until they've gotten every last drop of the marrow from your bones.
Hey, Teacup, why don't you chill out?
Very well. Oh, little Lulu, I love you, Lou, just the same.